Hello, Easton, and welcome to the Rabbi's Roundtable. I'm Rabbi Peter Hyman, rabbi at Temple B'nai Israel in Easton. And it's been a while since we've done a Rabbi's Roundtable, basically due to the high holidays that are now over. Thank God. That's a rabbinic comment. I'm sitting here with my friend Tracy Ward. Tracy is executive director of the Easton Economic Development Corporation, and she oversees Chesapeake Harvest, and we're going to talk a little bit about both. Tracy, welcome back to the Rabbi's Roundtable.
Thank you. Great to be back.
Glad to have you. So before we begin, let's talk a little bit, give us a little bit about your background, your professional background, and how you get to be with us, and how fortunate we are, and all
how
that
fortunate
stuff.
I am.
We're both fortunate, absolutely.
So I came to Easton to do this job for the Easton Economic Development Corporation about 4.5 years ago. A fantastic opportunity for me, coming from Baltimore. I've always done community partnerships, and we are doing some very interesting community development, economic development partnerships here in Easton on a number of fronts.
Well, I will tell the audience that I am really honored and feel very blessed to be on the EEDC
yes,
committee.
Thank you.
I, as I always tell you privately, I feel like a fish out of water. These are
not
such smart, business-oriented, successful individuals, yourself included, and I just sit there amazed at what's happening. And speaking about what's happening, let's talk about what's happening.
Sure.
What would you like to? What projects should we reference and share with the folk?
So a lot of folks probably are more familiar with our Port Street redevelopment project, and I think we've talked about that in the past. And that project is going well. The only comment I would make on that project today would be that the mayor just recently announced that he is interested in doubling the size of the waterfront park.
Oh, cool.
So we're all very excited to see something really positive happen on Easton Point.
Yeah.
At the head of the Trent-Avon River there. Incredibly beautiful opportunity for the town residents to go down, all the county residents actually.
That's going to be very exciting.
Yes.
What's the time projection? Any idea?
Well, there are some realities that, you know, in terms of businesses that may be moving, other businesses that may be coming. So these things do take time. But I think you're going to see some things going into place even this year with the completion of the bridge across the Trent-Avon River, which I think if you drive down now, you can actually see the bridge in place.
Yeah, I think so.
And then the trails will be underway in terms of construction. And then at the end of that project, we'll have 6 miles of trails through the town of Easton.
I think that's
remarkable.
So cool.
That's remarkable.
Really wonderful.
Yeah, yeah.
And it shows, the leadership, it shows some vision, some understanding of what communities need to solidify the concept of community, a livable community.
You're right.
I think that's it's just very exciting. And what about water issues? What are water quality and that?
That's
are we doing anything
great,
with the environment?
It's such a good question. So actually, I would argue that that's one of the main drivers of this project. Actually, we just had a very good meeting with NOAA, and they've been studying the river for 3 years. They're about to come out with a study that shows that the river does need care and attention. Even though a lot of incredibly smart, good things have been going on in the town in terms of managing the water runoff, as you know, we're seeing these deluges coming that we've never seen before.
No kidding.
Or if we have, it's been a very long time, but our systems are overwhelmed. When that happens, the dirt, the debris, and also the chemicals or whatever's on the ground goes straight into the river. And so we're seeing some of those effects in the Trent-Avon River. And so part of what we'll be doing as we put in a new park, as we see new streetscape happening along Port Street and other things as well, there will be systems developed where the water can be captured, filtered before it goes
wonderful.
Into the river. And then obviously improve that water health tremendously, make it swimmable again, make the fish safe to catch and eat.
That's
in
so,
that portion
that's
of
so
the
important.
River.
You know, as they've heard me say before, I'm an old Boy Scout, and the environment and ecology, not only because I'm a Boy Scout, but I grew up on Long Island Sound.
Absolutely,
and,
right.
And water quality, I remember when the Sound was really filthy, and then Governor Ribicoff of Connecticut said, "And we're ending this," and he started a program that went all the way up to the headwaters of the Connecticut River, which are up in Maine or Vermont or wherever, and what a difference it made in the quality of life, not only for the residents, but for the fish and the clams and the oysters.
And the fisheries, individuals who are making living on these waterways.
So I'm glad to hear that.
Yes.
And so we may see something within the year.
We're going to see a study that comes out, and then we're also already seeing the town making amazing strides in terms of dealing with some of this runoff.
I'm so glad.
Yes.
It's so important, and we are so blessed to live where we are in this natural beauty.
Yes.
That we do have a responsibility to the environment, not for ourselves and for it.
Right.
So good. What else is going on?
We've been working on our project Chesapeake Harvest.
Yes, let's talk about Chesapeake Harvest, because I think it's great.
Yes, yes. Chesapeake Harvest is our project where we're working with farmers to help them sell their products. These are products that they grow here.
Yep.
You probably don't realize this, but most of the food that we eat, we do import. So even though we have many farmers and much land around us and an opportunity to grow, extended growing season here in Maryland, most of our food is in fact imported. And so it's really important for the future of this region that we support our local farms, otherwise they fall under pressure for development into other kinds of uses. And also for this food security of our nation, quite frankly, as we're seeing interruptions, we're seeing food supplies issues starting to occur with the droughts in California. That was a great example of that. So there's a lot of really good reasons why we need to support our local farmers, help them to grow more, help them to reach wholesale markets. In order to do that, they need some assistance. And so we've developed a program called Chesapeake Harvest.
That's cool.
That works directly with the farmers.
And so if I want to get local produce through Chesapeake Harvest, what do I do?
So you could go to our website. Chesapeake Harvest does have a website.
Okay.
It's www.chesapeakeharvest.com.
And we will put that up on the screen after.
That would be great. And then if individuals wanted to, if they're individual and a homeowner, or are somebody living in Easton, a rent or whatever, but if they want to buy retail, you can just click the retail button. If you own a restaurant and you want to supply your restaurant with locally grown products, you can click on the wholesale button.
Oh, cool. And do many of our restaurateurs take advantage of this?
Yes, I would say that we're seeing increasingly number of restaurants jumping on board. I think more and more we're seeing the consumer really looking for the flavor that you can get out of your locally grown.
Yeah.
So as it turns out, it's more flavorful, it's fresh, it's more
more
nutrient dense, and you're buying local, so you're supporting your local farmer.
Did I see on one of the recent emails or communications that there's locally grown garlic?
Oh yes, we have gorgeous locally grown garlic. Yes.
I cook a lot.
Okay, yes.
And I get garlic
at
the grocery store.
Yep.
It's just, there's no flavor in it.
I know.
And I have to go and get some locally grown garlic.
We will get you some locally grown garlic.
All right.
There's a garlic grower that is actually on our site as well. He stops by our office all the time. He's great.
Okay.
Jim.
I'm going to do that.
We have other garlic growers as well. Garlic grows well here. It's amazing what will grow here on the Eastern Shore and in Maryland.
Then this is a question of ignorance. Is there a price advantage, cost to the restaurateurs who buy wholesale going with Chesapeake Harvest versus Cisco or whatever?
No, I would say that it's a price, probably more of a premium.
Okay.
Even. Okay. I would argue that there may be a premium, and it's a premium well worth it.
Yeah.
When you look at the flavor profile, when you look at the practices that were used to produce.
Uh-huh. Okay. Oh, yeah.
The food. And at the end of the day, you know, the flavor profile is what the restaurant is going to be after.
Sure.
You're not going to come back if the food is bland.
Right. Right.
So a lot of times they're willing to pay that premium.
Cool. All right. That's very exciting. Other things that we should be telling the public about?
Let's see. Well, we have a number of other initiatives going on in Easton that I think we should definitely be paying attention to. The Chamber of Commerce is doing a workforce development task force.
Uh-huh.
One of the things that's been in the news, I'm sure a lot of people have seen that so far our unemployment rate is extremely low.
Good.
And yes, it is good. Yet at the same time, we have many, 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 many individuals who would love to see their wages increase, get on a career path, mm-hmm. perhaps have more opportunity to move up. And so we have a number of businesses here in Easton, one of them that does background checks, another one that does builds air conditioning and heating units. So one, you know, manufacturing jobs. We have a new business that just opened called Sprout, Eat Sprout here in Easton. He does meals to go. Mm. So all of these places are hiring. These are very different kinds of jobs that are out there, and opportunities to grow your wage, opportunities to move up the ladder. So. Mm.
It's a very exciting world, and this speaks to me anyway. It speaks powerfully about the community in Easton.
Easton is a very special community.
I totally agree. I've been saying that.
It's a secret. We don't want to let it get out too
well,
much.
Well, that's
We wanted to make it really nice, and then we want to maybe cut off the bridge a bit here and there, but the economy is doing well here. There's more that we need to be doing,
sure.
and that's what we're all focused on, working very much in partnership with the county, the town, the Chamber of Commerce, the community, others.
Well, in my tenure here, I've definitely seen growth, in positive growth.
Yes,
in the 11 years that I've been here, it's really, inspirational in many ways.
Absolutely.
And the nature of the community, nothing is perfect, and I understand that, I'm not suggesting, but there's a good feel here, and it makes me happy.
You know,
it's a good place to be, and you certainly contribute to that by the work you do and the work that the EEDC, the Eastern Economic Development Corporation, does.
Yes.
And anything else we should be knowing about before we conclude this segment?
I want to make a quick pitch and say that buy local. Support your local businesses. Please support your local businesses. Support makers, people that are making mm-hmm. things. You know, with the retail disruption with Amazon, it's so easy for us to go in and just make those quick purchases and have it delivered. And I'm not trying to take those things away.
No.
But our local businesses need support.
Sure.
And it's fun. You get to know the person who's selling you the thing. You have a wonderful time doing it. So
to that point, it's really interesting. I grew up in a family that was in the jewelry business.
Oh, yes.
And I just shake my head. I don't understand how people can buy expensive jewelry
without looking at it.
Yes.
Trying it on.
You know, and my father, who never had a chance to get to Easton, he died, but he had a sign over his, my father was a trained jeweler and watch guy, but also built this store. He had a sign over his bench that said, "If you don't know jewelry, know your jeweler."
Absolutely.
I hear from people that I counsel for marriage, young mm-hmm. kids, mm-hmm. I always want to know, where did they buy their ring?
Oh, right.
And they say, "We got it on Amazon," or "We got it on online." I go, okay. It's anathema to me. So yes, what you just said is very important.
Yes. So support our local businesses.
Absolutely. We have been talking with the delightful Tracy Ward. Tracy, again, is Executive Director of the Eastern Economic Development Corporation. And thank you for sharing what's important, what's going on in the community. You will be back again and again.
That's a threat.
No, it's a promise. And we will be back momentarily.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Did you know? MCTV programming is available online. Find our shows like Rabbi's Roundtable, Carlisle's Chesapeake, The Shameless Picture Show, Conversations with Sherry, and the Avalon Theater Presents at youtube.com/Midshore Community Television.
And we are back, and welcome back, Easton, to the Rabbi's Roundtable. I'm Rabbi Peter Hyman, a rabbi at Temple B'nai Israel, and sitting with me now is somebody not unfamiliar to the Rabbi's Roundtable, Bishop Joel Marcus Johnson, but you'll note that the bishop is not wearing his collar. He's wearing a tie and jacket and a lovely white shirt, may I add.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Because Bishop Johnson is shifting a bit from the bishop's duty to a run for the judge of the orphan's court.
Right.
And welcome to the Rabbi's Roundtable.
Thank you. It's always good to be
Absolutely. Here. Absolutely. And let's talk a little bit. First, tell us what the Orphan's Court is.
Well, the Orphan's Court, the name, we inherited the name from the colonial period.
Yes.
Because in England, when a man died, his children were considered to be orphans, no matter if he still had if they still had a living mother. So that's how we get the name.
Yes.
And it's really a probate court. However, it does occasionally deal with such things as guardianships, mm-hmm. or has input into that from a probate point of view.
So, it's an important piece of the governmental structure.
Well, it is. As a matter of fact, the Orphan's Court is mentioned both in the original Constitution of Maryland and in the most recent, which was, I think, 1874, so that it is part of the Maryland judiciary. It is not strictly a county office. And there are other distinctions to this office here in Talbot County, and that is that it is lay administered. The judges are not attorneys,
correct.
Which is true for all of the nine counties here on the Eastern Shore, whereas on the Western Shore, you've seen the bumper stickers, of course, there is no civilization west of the bay. They have, those courts are made up entirely of attorneys, uh-huh. or sometimes the circuit court judge sits as the orphan's court.
Interesting.
Yeah.
And I understand. I mean, there's makes sense in some regard, but this is an interesting opportunity for you.
Well, it is.
So tell us a little bit. Oh, and I should say, by the way, that anybody who is running for office is always welcome to sit at the Rabbi's Roundtable. There's an obligation to be across the board and open to anybody, but we have a special friendship, and I'm glad you're here. So tell us what qualifies you for this. I can answer that, but you do it. I mean, being a bishop, yes.
Since you can answer it as well as I, just keep nodding your head as I say.
Yes, so yes.
The job for which I'm applying, for which I hope the voters will come out, is the same job as I've been doing for the last 35 years. This side, however, it's civil side. You know, a cleric, as you well know, people are constantly coming to the office or calling you up in the middle of the night with their family problems, and very often they have to do with inheritance or property issues,
all kinds of things.
So that in a very great sense, this work is something that I've already been doing this time. If I'm elected, I would be doing it civil side and applying the laws of the state of Maryland,
correct.
And beyond that, to the extent that the law permits, discretion and hopefully common sense. And since you ask what this entails, thank you for noticing that I'm not wearing the collar today. I've done a lot of thinking about this, that am I running as Citizen Joel Marcus Johnson or as Bishop Joel Marcus Johnson? And obviously it's the former. And even my wife and I have had some discussion about this, and I felt that it is not right to hang it over the other candidates, you know, using that credential.
However, that being said, it's difficult to dissect that part of you from your persona and who you are and how you are recognized. And I'm not suggesting that's a negative,
right?
But that's just a reality. You know, you walk out of the door and you are who you are.
Well, that's right. You know, and the charism of a bishop is one that is carried for a lifetime. It's a charism that I carry to the grave. So, yeah, you know, it's something that cannot be forgotten.
Correct.
So hopefully what goes along with that charism is the sense of compassion and the sense of endearment and understanding of the human qualities which bring some families to the orphans' court really hating each other and being able to communicate with them. It's not that way for all families, I assure you.
No, but, you know, people will ask, you know, what qualifies you to?
Well, yes.
And just the background, the study, canon law.
Yeah.
And this, you know, I taught a class the other night on what Jewish tradition teaches about the appointment of judges.
Yes.
This was in regards to the latest Supreme Court that whole rigmarole.
Yeah.
But it is clear that there are what you and I may have gone through in our academic and university training, seminary training, also has a real clear legal component to it.
Absolutely.
And of course the rabbis were originally not meant to be pastors; they were meant to be legal adjudicators.
Yes.
So right. Very interesting.
Yeah. Well, as a matter of fact, you know, bishops in the canon law of the church are also sit as judges.
That's correct.
I think that's a little less so here in the United States civil side.
Yes.
But in England, the bishops are also civil servants.
That comes directly out of the rabbinic foundation.
Absolutely.
Upon which Christianity develops.
Of course.
And it comes to its, you know, takes its really fulfillment in the Catholic Church.
Yes.
In the hierarchy of the church.
Yeah.
But tell us a little more about the Orphans Court. What motivated you to run? I mean, did you see issues? Do you see that you want to address as a now a public servant as opposed to a servant of the Lord?
Well, you never really quit being a servant of the Lord.
Yes,
you know,
I
always tell people this, that no one really retires from the church.
That's correct.
It's like the mafia. Every time I try to get out, they keep pulling me back in.
Yeah. But, I'm not sure. Never mind. It's fine.
But, you know, the ingredient of compassion and of looking out for other people is one that never leaves you after all those years. And I remember when I had the canon law of the church staring me in the face, knowing that I would have to retire when I hit the age of 71, it's okay. I'm proud of it. You know, I got to thinking, what do I do now? What's my next act? How do I serve the community?
Mm-hmm.
And at about the same time, and I don't know if I'm at liberty to say his name or not, he is very much alive and kicking, but a retired presiding judge of the Orphans Court asked me to very seriously consider running for it. And the more that I looked into, I thought to myself, yep, this is a good pairing.
Very good. So how do you think the court can be improved? Where do you think it needs some tweaking and that sort of thing?
Well, I think that one of the things that we need to do, and this is not only for the Talbot Orphans Court, you know, there is a statewide association of judges of orphans courts. And I think that we need to be studying the examples of such states as, say, Colorado, in which the judges, in addition to serving on the bench, also serve as community educators, getting out there in the community, talking with people about probate, what it is, how it can be helpful to you and your family, talking with people about having about creating wills,
mm-hmm.
Talking with people about doing active planning with their estates rather than waiting for their heirs to take care of all the burden
mm-hmm.
after their passing. You know, this is very important. The scriptures talk about during the time that Hezekiah was ill. You know, he was told to prepare for his final days.
Yes. Well,
and you know, I see it as being something very important for people to write not only their wills but also their testaments. You know, this is something which I see still being done in Judaism. I don't see it being done much at all in Christianity, in which we may have a last will, and then there's nothing.
Yes.
Last will and used,
oh,
to call, used to be called last will and testament. The testament part, in which you leave your spiritual will, your philosophic
exactly.
will, to those who come after you, to be able to say to them, these are the things for which I have strived, and I implore you
these
to
are
also
my,
carry
these
on.
These are my values. I pass them on.
Exactly.
I have this conversation with people often.
Yes.
About
right.
not only the ultimate prudent insight to have this done,
right?
But to then leave, and I mean, well, this being their physical stuff, the,
sure.
the money, the jewelry, the china, the silver, or whatever.
That's right.
But also
yeah.
The necessity to leave to the next generation something of what you thought was important.
Amen.
And what
right.
motivated you, and the values that you have embraced. When I deal with death and dying seminars,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
which you've done, we've done them together.
Why, sure.
This is important.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah, that educational component I think is going to be important.
Yeah.
And I think that raising it at the county level is one thing. I think it needs to be talked about with the association covering the whole state as
oh.
well, so that, you know, we may learn that other counties are already doing this.
Yeah,
so
well, I certainly would be supportive of that. I think it's,
yeah.
you know, just the raising of the awareness and the knowledge of the community is always important and
right.
good.
Right.
Election day is?
Well, there's early voting.
There's early voting. It starts next week, I believe.
Well, it begins on the 25th. And then Election Day on November 6th, I believe it is. I'm sure it is.
Yes, November 6th.
And listen, if you haven't registered yet, it's very easy to do. Go online. You can do it online.
Yes, everything's online.
Everything's online these days. If you don't have a computer, hey, stop by the county offices. They'll be happy to sign you up
yep.
to vote. And listen, Maryland is one of the few states that has... so strongly enabled the right of franchise to its citizens,
mm-hmm.
Whereas there are other states where they actively work to keep you from voting,
yes.
but not in Maryland.
That's a different,
take advantage of what this state has done for
you. That's a different discussion,
you.
And that's it reprehensible. Is. There was a huge report last night on the news. I don't know if you saw it.
I did not, but it's
we
I
won't go into
day.
It, but the
yeah.
thought of officials trying to limit the freedom to vote and
yeah,
the right to vote
right.
is reprehensible, but that's a different sermon. We have been talking with Joel Marcus Johnson, Bishop Johnson, who is running for the court of judge of the Orphans Court. We wish you good luck.
Why, thank you.
And you'll come back and we'll talk more. But as the bishop said, get out and vote. And Easton, we will see you next time at the Rabbi's Roundtable.
Peace be with you.